Well, hello there, and welcome to another edition of Warbird Wednesday. My name is Fred Bell, and I am back with my libro-cubicular-ist assistant. You know, it's tough when he gives me the word, and I actually have to break it up in order to make it work. Assistant Greg Kenny, and of course, today he has made me Gandalf the Paisano, I guess. So have you ever noticed Lord of the Rings? There's not an Italian guy in any of those things. They're always like British or New Zealand or something. Greg, we need to file a complaint, I think. I'm going to toss my hat off screen there. A great catch by the Kenny. And today what we're going to do is we're going to talk about, well, you know, we went back to the Wright brothers. Now we're going to talk about the very first warbirds. Everybody thinks that warbirds are like P-47s or P-51s or something in World War II or maybe World War I flying machines, but that is not the case. Actually, warbirds go all the way back to spherical artillery balloons back into 1794. They were first used by the French in the Revolutionary Wars at that time as artillery spotters or trying to find get up high and find formations of troops moving around. That's how that all started. Now, what we're going to do today is we're going to show you some things in the museum that when you come here, you can amaze your friends because you're going to go, I know what that is. And, oh, let's go find this. Now, these are things that are too big for us to house. You're going to understand what I mean by that in a minute. But we do have some of the artifacts that you can go find in the museum. So the observation balloon, as I said, started to be used in 1794. It was used in the American Civil War. It was used in the Franco-Prussian War. So these are before the turn of the last century. So think about that. They're up there with hydrogen, which is flammable, right? It is flammable. We'll talk about that a little later. But they're basically up there, and they were typically released. The balloons were fabric. They were round. And they were typically on the end of a cable. Those were the very early rudimentary ones. And they were used to spot for artillery. Now, the oldest known surviving fabric artillery balloon is in a museum in Vienna. So, Greg, your mission is to find that balloon and take a picture of it somewhere at some point. And maybe you can find it in post. But it's in Vienna. Or if, when COVID lifts, you can go and take a trip to Vienna. Oh, he's smiling now. Now he's like, oh, that's not a bad job. So, but the oldest known one is that's on display is in Vienna. They were made out of fabric, and they were very rudimentary. Now, what you're going to find in the museum is when you go over to the kids' play area, you're going, and Greg can throw this up again in post, we have an observation gondola hanging there. And Greg can throw up a picture of that. They were not complicated. Again, you just had a guy with a pair of binoculars. In the early days, he would write down the bad guys are coming from certain, or he would watch artillery fall, and he would basically walk the artillery in as to where they wanted it to go. They'd give them coordinates, you know, up, down, so many degrees, or left or right, and that's what they were used for. Now, the reporting from them got a little bit more sophisticated when they developed intercoms, and we went into World War I. Now, in World War I, we moved away from the spherical balloons, and we moved into what's called kite balloons. And you've seen those. They're kind of long, and they have fins on them. The Germans had them. They were Percival Siegfeld balloons over the inventor. And the French, and I'm going to screw this one up, they were cacos or cacouts, but I'm going to destroy that pronunciation. But Greg can find them in post and throw them up. But there were two different types of balloons. The folks that were in those at that time now were, they were equipped with parachutes. Did you know that, Greg? And very rudimentary parachutes in that a lot of those parachutes, the parachute, rather than worry about the pack opening, how we think parachutes work, the parachute was actually suspended up in the balloon itself, or up in the rigging, And so when the guy jumped out, it would just immediately deploy. Because if you think about that, the balloon's up a couple hundred feet, you jump out, you got to wait for the parachute to deploy, you go boom, that doesn't work. Boom, that's a technical term, that means you hit the ground, and that's a bad day for everybody. So you don't want to do that. Now, probably the best depiction, because the Allies and the Germans, both sides, were trying to knock these balloons down because they didn't want them out there. They would go out with the fighters, and the fighters would be loaded with incendiary rounds, rounds that had a little bit of phosphorus in them or some other type of flaming material. But later we would talk about tracer rounds. You'd see them in World War II. You'd see the lines going out. And that would be used to ignite the hydrogen. Probably the best depiction that I've seen of the aircraft attacking those types of balloons is in the Blue Max, where they're trying to train him to go out after simple targets, and they go out and they go after these observation balloons. Now, there's one thing. Both sides defended the balloons heavily. There's a lot of anti-aircraft, a lot of AAA in there. So it was not just an easy day at the office to go out and shoot these balloons down once the enemy had them in place, because they protected them. They wanted to keep them up. And so there was a lot of anti-aircraft artillery. Now, Greg, what is the one problem with a kite balloon or a spherical balloon? The enemy knows where they are, right? They're totally obvious where they are. What the bad part is, they just don't move very well. So as the line moves, you can't just have the balloon kind of walk forward and track with the enemy. They're very difficult to move. And that created, although it was being done before the war, which is what we're going to start with, that created the need for, later it was done with aircraft, but with dirigibles or semi-rigid or rigid airships that were powered through the air by engines, by propellers. And that really, we're going to go with probably the folks that are most well-known. Do you know who those people are, Greg? Zeppelin. He was the guy that got it going. Now, a dirigible, we talked about dirigible. Dirigibles were essentially non-rigid. They're like big gas bags, which is kind of what Greg refers to me sometimes. And they were pushed around. The dirigible is a French term. And the guy that really started powered dirigibles or these bags was Henry Giffard in 1852. So we talk about where the Wright brothers started, but full 75 years prior to this, you've got all kinds of lighter than air things going on, but it's done primarily with hydrogen and these gas-filled spheres that they're moving around. Now somebody, and Henry Giffard had an idea in 1852 that you strap a engine to that, right? Now, that's a bad combination because hydrogen's flammable and you have combustion with the engine, which is dangerous as all get out, but they still were strapping engines to these things to try to drive them around. And that was happening in the middle of the 1800s. So Zeppelin, Ferdinand, I like Ferdinand. Kind of close to Fernando or Fred, right? Good reference, Greg. But Ferdinand started the company and then he also, interestingly enough, with Zeppelin in 1909, they founded the first airline, if you can believe that, because they started hauling people in these rigid airships with the gas bags built inside of them. In World War I, Zeppelins were the first, Greg, strategic bombers. If you could think about that, they were the first strategic bombers. They gave the British fits, so much so that the Allies at the end of World War I, they actually demanded that Zeppelin turn over all of their airships. And in 1920, they were all destroyed because they were picked up as reparations by the Allies. A lot of people that say that the Treaty of Versailles, which reparations were under, that treaty actually set the stage for the start of World War II because it was so draconian to the defeated Germans and their allies. And we can debate that, but not here today, Greg. So in we know that Zeppelin, at the end of World War I, lost all of their equipment. The Allies took it. In the interwar period, they started working on these really big airships again. And the one thing I want to be careful is people are going to say in the comments, well, there are other people working on airships. And there absolutely were. We're only focusing on Zeppelin because Zeppelin was pretty much out there on the cutting edge at that time of this work. And I want to talk a little bit about where Zeppelin has come since that time. But there are other people working on it. But Zeppelin was the highest profile group that was working on these aircraft at this time. Now, the best known probably in the interwar period is the LZ, the 129, the Hindenburg. And the Hindenburg obviously had a few problems, and ultimately the disaster where the Hindenburg was lost ended that kind of interwar, I would say, golden age period where these were being used for air travel. And in 1940, all of the works from the Zeppelin folks, anything that they had in production was scrapped and turned into German war material for the Luftwaffe, which was rearming for World War II. Now, behind me is, and this is another thing we talked about, that observation balloon basket. This is something, and you'll see there's a dirigible up there with it. That is a Zeppelin propeller. So when you come to the museum, we could not house a Zeppelin, but we actually have the exhibit of one of them. That gives you an idea of the engine size and the. But imagine that there were 15 or 20 of these things on the airship, and they were powering these, and there were crews that manned them. These aircraft were enormous. But with the disaster of the Hindenburg, where it blew up one, hydrogen went by the wayside. Helium, there's a big argument about helium being too expensive and the Germans didn't use it, whatever. We're not going to go down that path today because we're just doing an overview. But it pretty much ended this interwar period. All the aircraft were scrapped, and that was pretty much it. Now, that wasn't the end of these balloons or these dirigibles. The Goodyear had anti-submarine blimps, which essentially are the non-rigid version. They have no frame. They were flying around all over the place. They had depth charges on them. They would actually go out on convoy patrols. Goodyear had those, and those blimps went around. There were barrage balloons, which were similar to the observation balloons, and what those were put up for is they had cables, and the idea behind that, Greg, was to eliminate low-flying aircraft coming over and trying to bomb targets. They would put them up, and they'd have cables, and the idea was they would damage the wings of the airplanes as they were going through, and they couldn't get down low enough to get an attack. And so although they were really prevalent in World War I, by World War II, all of these types of filled gas bags, so to speak, as I said, were pretty much gone by the wayside. So in 1940, Zeppelin was out of the airship business at the direction of Germany that was rearming. Now, an interesting Fred fun fact, Greg, is they got involved in building V2 parts for Hitler's vengeance weapon, the V1, the buzz bomb. V2 was the rocket. They were actually building V2 parts and at their factories. The Allies figured this out and basically bombed them out of existence. They destroyed their factories so that by the end of World War II, Zeppelin was completely out of business. They were done. So what I want to do now is I am going to go to my salute. I want to salute all of these folks that you got to remember, if you're going up in a balloon on a cable or you are getting in a gas-filled hydrogen bag and driving around with a little inline 8 motor or something like that, that took a lot of guts. These were true pioneers in every sense of the term. And it's hard to believe in 1852 or in 1908 when they were starting working on this, whether it was the artillery observation balloon or these rigid airships, this was cutting edge technology. I mean, this was space shuttle type stuff back then. It had not been done. They were learning how to do it. There were people being killed all the time in these various inventions. So what I want to do today is I want to salute all of the folks that were pioneering in this area, because whether we want to admit it or not, all the work they did, the control services, the ailerons, the rudders, a lot of the propeller technology and the engine technology came out of these airships and these rigid airships, and then was basically just worked into more and more sophisticated fixed-wing aircraft as technology advanced. So to all those early airship folks, I salute you. And today, I'm being remiss. Gandalf the Italian is being remiss in that I am having Flying Cauldron butterscotch beer. But now, before everybody runs to, this is a non-alcoholic beverage. It only has 150 calories. Again, Greg buys this from where I don't know, but it says it's a magical brew, but there is no sell-by date. So one of these days, Greg's going to get lucky and give me a botulism poisoning, and then there'll just be a little sign that says, Fred won't be here this week. Man. That's either been on the shelf too long, or there's a lot more scotch than butter in there, because that thing has a bite. We're going to do one more, and then I'm going to go have my stomach pumped, I think. But, Greg got me this week. Oh, man. Wow. Okay. Well, we're going to salute those folks, and I just took one for the team there. But the finish on that is, that's terrible, Greg. That's bad. Okay, so at that point, you would say Zeppelin's been bombed out of existence. The European economy at the end of World War II is completely destroyed. They're just gone. They're a footnote in history, and we're going to have models and stuff like that. But Zeppelin actually revived itself, and this is something we don't have enough time here, but I'd like to actually go into that. They revived themselves in the 1980s, if you believe that. They came back that far after the war from their assets and started, from their residual assets, and started building semi-rigid airships, the Zeppelin NT series, which they've built 7. Now, the interesting thing is you have Goodyear up here, and I actually think, I don't know, Greg, I don't think that's a blimp. In other words, which is just the non-rigid, I think that is one of the LZ, the NT series, which is a Zeppelin. Goodyear went back and partnered with Zeppelin on those aircraft, and there's actually 3 stationed in the United States. Did you know that? So Zeppelins, even this far, so think about that, over 100 years since the company was founded by the Count, they're still operating aircraft and building these. Now, these are semi-rigid aircraft. The maximum speed is 77 miles an hour, so they're not speed burners. They can carry up to 12 passengers or the equivalent amount of weight in cargo. And that is really, really interesting. Now, one thing, if Greg can get a shot of it, the tail on the Zeppelin, these new NT series, the propulsion system is really cool. And Greg, if you can get that in post, where the propellers are and how the propulsion system works on it, it's very interesting compared to where the blimps were, which had those outrigger fans on them. And these NT Zeppelins are very, very interesting. So hopefully Greg can get that in post. Now, if you are an aficionado at home and you are interested in the history of aviation, we actually have a puzzle here suitable for framing. You'll have the fun of building that you can frame it, but starts out with what I was talking about, which is all the way back to the spherical balloons, the very early spherical balloons, the dirigible or the Henry Giffard aircraft, up to the Zeppelins or Zeppelin equivalents, and then it goes forward into the heavier than airplanes. This is something really cool, and if you want to have something that kind of picks up that history, this is the opportunity to do that. You can get that in our gift shop. go click on the link and you can get that. Now, remember, when you're in the museum, look for that basket over by the kids area in B-17, and the Zeppelin propeller is actually in our Miles classroom. You get a docent to show you that. You get a picture. That's a good way to win a bar bet. You can say, I know where there's a Zeppelin propeller, which is not too many people can pull that one off. Now, remember, we cannot do any of this or preserve any of this history without your donation. So click on that link and shoot us a donation. Hopefully today we earned your subscription on YouTube. Subscribe to us on YouTube. You can like us on YouTube, like us on Facebook. Tell your friends about us. And we will see you next week for another edition of Warbird Wednesday. Thank you so much. Have a great day.